No question about it. He's obviously an absolute killer. You've been facing nothing but absolute killers. But when you look at him, is he more dangerous, less dangerous than some of the other guys you've been facing?
There's so many variables when you're talking about dangers in mixed martial arts. He's as dangerous as any of the other top guys I've fought, just in different areas. You know, his submission game, numbers don't lie. He's one of the most dangerous, most dangerous ever to hit the canvas in the UFC. And we didn't put that aside in training camp. You know, we really focused on defense and fight IQ on the ground and where I'm at in the rounds and risks we need to take. So, you know, he's very dangerous.
Last thing for me, I mean, I guess it's this moment to enjoy it first, right? But what is your plan as champion, right? I mean, you've done everything. You fought everybody. Like, do you see, like, I'm going to win and have this long reign? Or is it like, man, I'm going to get there and maybe that's about it for me? You know what I mean? What's the plan?
I'm not sure. I haven't really looked that far. You know, I have to perform Saturday night and get that belt. And then we'll take it from there. But sitting here thinking about it, you know, I'll probably defend the belt. I do believe one day I'm going to fight at 170 pounds in the UFC. I'm not sure if I'm going to make a title run, a career run, and you know. But I'm 32. I'll be 33 next month. I still feel good. I'm injury free. I feel healthy, so I can continue to do this as long as my body allows me, and I feel good. But the goal is just to put that world champion next to my name and cement that in history. That's all I'm really focused on.
Dustin, right here. I think from the fans' perspective, a lot of people view Charles Oliveira as this high-level elite grappler, but lately he's been putting away a lot of people, or at least setting up submissions with his hands. You've obviously fought in, like, the Anthony Pettis's, the Holloway's, the Connors. So how would you rate his striking compared to a lot of the other peoples in the division?
He's dangerous. He throws big knees, big kicks, power shots. He keeps himself protected, throws a good sharp hook that he hit Chandler with. He does a lot of things well on the feet. Not a big volume puncher, not the best footwork, but very aggressive and not a point fighter. You know, he's trying to finish you.
And then I know you've touched on this a lot, but a lot of people think, even like Justin Gaethje, you said that your will is just stronger than Charles Oliveira. Charles Oliveira, quote, breaks, but that was what, like four years ago when he broke against Paul Felder. Do you still view him as that same fighter? Is that always going to be there, or is that just so long in the past you can't even take that into consideration?
I mean, if it's in there, we'll find out. But I can't bank on that, you know. We'll see. He showed grit in his last fight against Chandler. You know, he got hurt, almost got finished, came back and knocked the guy out. So if that's, you know, your last fight is the one I go off of, and he showed championship grit.
Dustin, back here, right in the middle. We saw on Embedded, you were talking to your daughter through the video chat. Are they going to be here for the fight, the family, this week?
They land today. This is my daughter's first fight week. Yeah, they land today.
All right, cool. I was going to ask, is it stressful for you to have them, or is it kind of more motivating, like distraction-wise? How do you kind of view having them?
No, I love my family, and they come with me to training camp the whole time. And she was actually born on the day that Nate Diaz fought Connor. I forget what UFC number that was, but we were in the hospital room, rented it from UFC.com on my laptop, went pick up some food. You know, she was born into this. She, you know, I have a gym back home. She was raised in the gym too. This is just life. It's not a big deal to her, you know.
And I know that you miss Thanksgiving, so sorry to bring it up, but what's your favorite pie, man?
Damn, I like pecan pie, man. I really do. I'm going to catch up on all that for Christmas.
There you go. Best of luck, Dustin.
Hey, Dustin, right here. Dustin, not only yourself, but you got two other Louisiana guys fighting on the card. Is that any extra motivation? I know they're not necessarily direct teammates, but do you feel like there is going to be a bit of setting the bar early for the South?
Man, we got to put on for Louisiana for sure. I know both guys pretty well. Me and Matt actually have trained together for years and years and years. We were at the same gym for a while. In Louisiana, he came out to American Top Team. We were training together there. So, and I've been knowing him for a long time. I've cornered him before he made it to the UFC. So it's good to see those faces and be around those guys on fight week. You know, we're a long way from the rodeo arenas we fought in Louisiana.
And to talk to you a little bit about other stuff going on in the lightweight division, just your thoughts on the other big fight coming up, Makhachev versus Beneil Dariush.
It's a fun matchup, you know. Dariush is on a streak. Makhachev is dangerous. We'll get to see how good his ground game really is when they hit the mat. You know, obviously his wrestling's really good, but Dariush is dangerous in all positions. It's a fun fight. You know, the lightweight division has, I've said it over and over again, been very top heavy for the last few years. And it seems like it's not going anywhere.
Is Justin Gaethje a different guy than when you fought him, in your opinion?
I'm not sure. It's tough to say. You know, I know a lot of people thought he made a huge jump when he fought Tony, and I do think he is improving. I just think Tony made him look really good as well. It was a good matchup. But no, he's tough, man. He's tough.
Final one. You've got the original. You've got the knockout edition. If you win the belt, is there going to be a championship edition hot sauce?
Man, we're launching this week a three-pack with gold labels for championship week. It's not a different sauce. It's the same original sauce with gold labels. We're going to do a limited run of 2,100 because this is going to be my 21st win in the UFC. And $10 from every pack is going to the Good Fight Foundation. We're trying to raise money for Second Harvest Food Bank to provide 300,000 meals in Louisiana to underserved communities that need it. So, yeah, we're trying to tie everything in together.
Thank you, and good luck. Yeah.
Oh, mic's off. Your last two fights had a lot of kind of emotional buildup with Connor. How's this one different in terms of, like, your headspace for this particular fight?
It's smooth sailing, you know, not a lot of back and forth. He seems respectful, but at the end of the day, it's a fight. You know, this is warfare when we get in there. So the more mature me, I don't really pay all that a whole lot of mind. Even in the Connor fights and the buildup, I didn't really get too caught up in it. I don't really care about that stuff anymore. I know what matters. So even if this was a crazy back and forth verbal exchange, it wouldn't, when the bell rings Saturday night, it's going to be the same result.
Just a follow-up to that, your wife was also involved in some back and forth. At least it got to her when you were fighting Connor. How's she doing with this particular fight? Is there a lot of relief in the house this time around?
There wasn't any tension in the house before. Just like I said, when my daughter was born into this, my wife drove me to my first fight. I didn't have a car. She drove me across state lines to Arkansas, and I fought in a rodeo arena back in 2007, maybe. So she knows this game as well as, you know, probably better than some people in the car.
Dustin, hey, here in the back. As you mentioned, there's a lot going on in the lightweight division, and it seems like Justin Gaethje will be the next one to challenge after this. But there was a lot of talk about that. A lot of people felt Makhachev deserved it. In your opinion, who is the most deserving lightweight to challenge for the title after this fight?
I don't know, man. That's Dana, Sean, and Mick's job. I don't play matchmaker. I just try to put these guys away. Like I said, it's top heavy. I'm not sure. You know, Gaethje had a title fight and then won one since then, right?
Yeah.
But he beat a guy coming. Chandler was coming off a win. So I don't know, man. It's tough. It's been murky waters. It's hard to, you know, pick who's next.
And you mentioned moving up to welterweight in the future. Obviously, Colby Covington has had a lot of negative things to say about you, and that's where he resides. Is that a fight that interests you in the future?
We'll see. I'm not sure how soon I'm going to make that jump, you know, especially if I become the world champion Saturday. I have to, you know, defend the belt, and I have to be here for a while and establish myself as a world champion. But everybody's on the list if I move up, you know.
Dustin, down here to your left. You touched on, obviously, the win being your 21st, if you get it. But I believe in January 1st will be the 10-year anniversary of you making UFC debut at UFC 125.
11 year.
Oh, 11 year. I can't even count, Matt, anyway. But anyway, how would you assess the journey? Because you've had ups and downs, and you picked yourself back up off the figurative canvas many times. So how would you assess the journey so far?
Beautiful, man. A learning experience. It helped me become the fighter I am, but also the person I am. You know, I just hope I can pass on these lessons I've learned to my daughter, to other fighters in the future. You know, it's more than fighting. It's life lessons. And I'm just happy with the person I've become.
And I know you're not one to overlook your opponents or whatever, but having had the interim belt wrapped around your waist, have you thought of what the feeling will be like when you have the undisputed one wrapped around your waist in front of a packed crowd?
Man, when I do think about it, I just think about the next day. Not the moment, the next day when I can exhale. Because it's still going to be, you know, I'm going to win this fight, do media, go back to my hotel. It's still a rush of madness, you know. But when I get on that airplane with my wife and daughter the next day and I can exhale, nobody's asking questions, and I can hold the belt with my family, that's what I think about, that feeling. And I can't wait to see what it feels like.
Thank you.
Dustin, kind of right here. In that same vein, you've talked a lot about that promise you made to Jolie about being the undisputed champion. I know you didn't feel, in that sense, completely fulfilled with the interim title. Is that something you're thinking about much this week?
Yeah, that's... If I can become the world champion Saturday night, I've done it all in the sport. Everything I've set out to do, I've set my family up. We're in a good position financially. I have other businesses outside of the, you know, outside of fighting going on. I have to check that box. That's forever. You know, I was saying 25 minutes to make life fair. This is 25 minutes for eternity. 25 till eternity. That's what this is. You don't take that away. Once a champion, always a champion. And it's very important for me and my wife, you know, to none of this was done in vain, regardless of what happened Saturday night. But it just cements everything that we thought.
And last thing, I know you retweeted that graphic I put about the stats in this fight, you know, most finishes, most wins, bonuses. Can you try to put into context, I know you're a fight fan, like the specialness and the uniqueness of this matchup between you and Charles?
Me and Mike were just talking about it whenever that graph came out. We were sitting at the kitchen table, and I don't ever sit back and like reminisce or look at all the stats, longevity stats like that, but thinking about it is crazy because it doesn't feel like I've been doing, you know, it's happened so quick. Even though it was 10 years, it happened so quick. It goes by so quick, and all the things you know, accomplish and add up and stack to the record books. I never sit down and look at it all, but to see that on the graph and to start looking, we started pulling up other records and stuff, and it's crazy, man. It's a good feeling.
Dustin, just one more back here. On the top, as I mentioned, the welterweight division before, the hottest rising guy there right now has got to be Khamzat Chimaev. Everyone's talking about it, and some people saying he's a future champ. Some people saying he's a little overhyped. Where do you stand? What's your opinion?
I'm a fan. I want to, you know, when he's on the card, I'm buying the pay-per-view or watching. You know, it's exciting. That's what makes me want to watch to find out if he's that guy, to see him compete. So, and I think the sport needs that. We need stars to stay in the to keep people interested. Not that they wouldn't be without it, but it's fun when you have a guy like that. Is this a real special person? And we're going to find out.
And last one from you, then. You were on Hot Ones, and you went through some pretty spicy sauces. Did that in any way affect or inspire you to try some of your own super spicy sauces in the future?
We launched a KO edition, and, man, that's about my limit. That's, you know, that's about my limit that I can enjoy before it becomes like a gag gift. You know, anything that's too hot is like you're going to use it one time to mess your friend up, and that's it. You know, we'll see.
All right, thank you.
Thanks. Undisputed.